Yes.
Okay.
Is
Hello,
that
everyone. We wish
hello?
you a
Yes.
very good afternoon. We hope you all are safe and healthy. Welcome to Law Colloquio's webinar on inter-country adoption, filiation versus paternity. Before beginning the discussion, I would like to pass on certain instructions to our participants. Kindly mute yourselves throughout the webinar. If you have any questions, kindly put them in the chat box below and I will be addressing them later. Before beginning, participants, kindly put yourself on mute. Before beginning, I would like to tell you all a brief about Law Colloquio. Law Colloquio has been created for documenting short, precise, and substantive articles, videos, and news on perceptions regarding various important topics of law. Our aim is to make people familiar with different theories, statutes, laws, and to help one understand and develop the legal mindset. We also conduct webinars, seminars, workshops, and training programs on different aspects of the law for targeted groups. Today, we are honored to have Dr. Shivani Verma as a resource person for our webinar. Dr. Verma is presently an assistant professor at the Faculty of Law, University of Delhi. Ma'am has over 14 years of teaching experience at various reputed law schools in India. She is an LLB gold medalist from Kulkshetra University. Dr. Verma cleared her NET in the year 2005 and completed her PhD in law from Kulkshetra University on the topic female trafficking in India in the year 2013. Ma'am has worked on a project sponsored by the National Commission for Women on the increase in rape cases in Haryana as a research associate. Ma'am, it's an absolute honor to have you with us today. Without any further ado, I give the floor to you.
Thank you so much, Priyal, for such a profound introduction. So before we begin with the topic and before we start discussing the intricacies related to inter-country adoption, I would like to tell you a bit more about what exactly we are going to discuss today. Because inter-country adoption itself is quite a vast topic. It has lot many dimensions, lot many intricacies. So we are going to touch two perspectives today. One is the perspective of the child and one is the perspective of the parents. That is why the subtopic says filiations versus paternity. So what exactly do we mean by filiation? Filiation is granting affiliation, granting alliance to a child with a family. And paternity is basically more about parents getting a child. There are various reasons that a family is not having a child, parents are childless. So this is the perspective which deals about parents getting a child, and filiation talks about a child getting a family. So the whole concept is different in the terms of prevalence. When we talk about filiation, it's the benefit, it's the welfare of the child which would prevail over anything else. And when we talk about paternity, it's the welfare of the parents which would prevail about anything else. So that's all about the topic. Before going further about inter-country adoption, let me share my slides with you. Just a second. So that's the topic. That's the topic. Inter-country adoption, filiation versus paternity. So what exactly do we mean by adoption? Because before we move on to inter-country adoption, definitely we would like to clarify what exactly is adoption, whether we are talking about in-house adoption or we are talking about inter-country adoptions. There are definitely some dimensions which are added when we talk about inter-country adoption, but adoption, the basic concept remains the same. Okay, so what do we mean by adoption? There are lot many definitions of adoption you would come across, but I have shortlisted these two dimensions specifically because these are widely used definitions. So first one is Black's Law Dictionary, how the adoption concept is defined. It says adoption is the act of one who takes another child into his own family, treating him her as his own and giving him her all the rights and duties of his own child. So again, this is a perspective wherein we are talking about a family taking a child in adoption and granting him rights at par with any biological child. So again, this perspective is more paternity based perspective. Okay, the second one is CARA ka definition, which is Central Adoption Resource Agency, the topmost agency which is responsible for adoptions in India. How the agency came into the picture, how it was created, we'll come to it later. Now we are focusing right now on the meaning of adoption. So what exactly is adoption as per CARA? Adoption means the process through which adoptive child is paternity separated from the biological parents and become legitimate child of his adoptive parents with all his rights, privileges, and responsibilities that are attached to the relationship. So as you can see in the slide, I have divided it into two parts. One is the orange part and the latter one is the green part. Why this separation, this distinction? Because first part of the definition is a negative aspect, a negative connotation, and the second part is more a positive connotation of the whole concept. The first part is talking about detaching a child from a biological family, biological parents. So herein, we are taking away a child permanently from his biological parents. And it is not as cruel as it sounds, because there are various reasons. There are legal reasons, justifications on the basis of which there is legal process by which we are going to do this detachment procedure. Okay. And because we are taking away something from the child, it's a negative connotation. We are granting him something in return. What exactly is the positive thing which we are granting to the child? The child is going to become a legitimate child of the adoptive parents. What do we mean by making a child a legitimate child of an adoptive parents? He will have all the right. Now the positive aspect, we are granting him rights, we are granting him privileges, we are granting him responsibilities also, obviously, that are attached to that relationship. So there are two connotations, one is negative and one is positive. Detached him, because definitely there are reasons. Probably it is not in his welfare to stay in the permanently biological parents ke saath apne. So we are detaching him from his biological parents, and positively we are giving him in adoption to a family jiske saath he'll get rights, privileges, and responsibilities as at par with any other biologically born son in the same family. Okay, so that's about the adoption initially. Now, what exactly is the adoption ke consequences? Adoption is a juridical act. It's an act which has been done through legal intervention. Now, the relationship which is created after adoption is a purely civil kind of relationship, and that is of paternity and filiation together. That's the consequences of the adoption. That's how the family, the newly created family after adoption, will have a status that it is a juridically created family. The nature is civil nature. Now coming to inter-country adoption. Now, inter-country adoption is an ordinary adoption. There is one additional dimension which is added to it, that the concept of adoption has crossed the territory. Now, there is a person who is not living in India, for example, and that person is adopting a child from India. So there are two countries in the picture. The process, the concept has crossed the territory. The person who is adopting is not residing in India. The child who is being adopted is definitely a child who belongs to India, who is an Indian child. And hence there are two laws in picture. And that is why Indian inter-country adoption becomes intricate, a bit complicated as compared to any in-house or in-country adoption. These kind of adoptions are broad categorized as stranger adoptions, because there is the stranger residing somewhere outside the territory of India who is adopting a child. And I'm giving example of India because we are going to deal with Indian inter-country adoption laws. Throughout the world, inter-country adoption is basically where two parties, the child and the parent, they belong to two different countries. Now, what exactly is the process of evolution of adoption in India? Now we'll focus about the laws in India. Firstly, the adoption-related laws and how these laws were widened to incorporate the inter-country adoptions also in them. So how the adoption process started. Initially, we had this Indian Majority Act of 1875. The act was based on father's consent only. If father has a consent, if father is willing to give away a child in adoption, he would not require the permission or consent or willingness of his wife. The father can give away a child in adoption to any of the adopting parents. But definitely the act was confined within the territory of India. There was no cross-border, cross-territory kind of element in these kind of adoptions. Then in 1956, we have Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act, which is very much in force right now also. But the only shortcoming from the perspective of inter-country adoption in this act is that, number one, the act deals with the adoption amongst the Hindus only. And secondly, the act had no reference whatsoever about inter-country adoption. So yes, the act is prevalent right now, but it talks about Hindu adoption, which is happening within the country. Then we have Guardian and Wards Act. So this is basically minorities ke liye, jo Hindus ke except we have minorities in India. So those communities, if they want to give their child in adoption or take the adoption procedure as such is not recognized here. The concept here is that if a child has nobody to take care of him or her, he can have a person appointed as his guardian through this act. Okay, so there is no concept of adoption per se in this legislation, but definitely there was an indication that if you are not having someone to take care of you, the child can ask for a guardian. Now, this guardian would be responsible to take care of the child and his welfare. Again, there is no reference of inter-country adoption in this legislation also. 1970s, there is no reference of, forget about inter-country adoption, but also adoption which was happening across the religion within India, or cross-ethnicity adoptions were also not taking place in India. Although we get few of the examples, but it was not very prevalent. It was not very popular amongst the communities in India. We see one example of Feroz Khan, a Parsi who was adopted by Mahatma Gandhi. But again, it was not documented. It was not done through legal intervention. It was more sort of an understanding, more sort of a message which Mahatma Gandhi wanted to give. So that is an example where cross-ethnicity or cross-religious adoption started taking place in India as well. Now coming to the legal regime of inter-country adoption in India, we have certain international legal frameworks, and then we have our domestic legislations also, which take care of inter-country adoption. We have United Nations Convention on Rights of Children, on Rights of Child. This is of 1989. We have Hague Convention, again, talking about inter-country adoption. This convention is of 1993. Both the conventions are ratified by India. And then we have Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act of 2015. Now, this is one hardcore legislation talking about the welfare of the children and all the aspects related to welfare of the children, which includes adoption, whether it is in-country adoption or inter-country adoption. And then we have one particular case which specifically I have mentioned there, which is Lakshmikant Pandey versus Union of India. This is one case which had a very progressive judgment given by the Supreme Court, and this case in a way changed the whole scenario, it was a paradigm shift basically in India, which we saw after this case, that there was a need, and Supreme Court basically took the opportunity and streamlined all the inter-country adoptions and the process related to inter-country adoption, how there was a need to establish an agency which will regulate, which would protect the child when he was going for inter-country adoption. That is why this case basically is quite an important case when we are studying inter-country adoption. Now we'll deal with the concept of these conventions, and I'll just be really brief in explaining only the relevant part I will be touching. So there are two articles which we specifically need to refer here when we are talking about United Nations Convention on the Rights of Child, 1989, what and how. Okay, what exactly this convention wants to do for the right of children and how exactly the convention wanted to do that. These two articles are going to tell us exactly what was the objective and what and how they wanted to achieve that objective, particularly in relation to inter-country adoption. So coming to Article 20. So Article 20 talks about what exactly we want to do. So there is a child who is deprived of his or her family environment. Now it is the responsibility of the state to ensure that he is deprived of his family. What is an alternative care method I can provide to him? Okay, the state has to ensure this. And while taking care of this particular child, they can include various mechanisms. They can go for foster placement, they can go for adoption, they can place these children in suitable institutes. Okay, so these are few of the mechanisms, few of the methodologies which can be adopted by the state while taking care of this particular child who has been deprived of his or her family. Now coming to Article 21, Article 21 basically tells or guides the states, okay, this is what you are supposed to do and this is how we are guiding you to do that. Okay, so when the state is taking care of these children who are being deprived of their family, there are certain things they have to keep in their mind, the state. Okay, so during the adoption, the best interest of child shall be the paramount consideration. Now this is again a perspective which is a filiation based perspective. We are keeping welfare of a child as our topmost priority. Okay, so for state, during adoption, the best interest of the child shall be the paramount consideration for him, for the state rather. Ensure adoption with due process, because if the adoption is not being done with due process, there are a lot many people who would take advantage of this child who is not having a family, who is rather in a very vulnerable condition. So there are chances of him being exploited by the agencies also, by the people also. So it is the responsibility of the state to ensure that every child who is going for the adoption is given an adoption through the due process only. Second is inter-country adoption as an alternative means of child care. So here we are emphasizing on a fact that it is not necessary that because we are calling or because we are giving responsibility to a state, state would fulfill that responsibilities only while being within its own territory. No, because there is this welfare of the child which is the topmost consideration, the topmost priority. If you have to cross your territory, if you have to go beyond your territory to find a suitable family for the child, you can do that as well. Okay, so state can adopt an inter-country adoption as an alternative mean for child care. Third is equal protection in national and international, sorry, inter-country adoption. So again, it is the responsibility of the state to ensure that child is protected, even if it is given for inter-country adoption, he is going to have protection there as well. This is the responsibility of the state who has given the child in adoption to some other state as in to the citizen of any other state. The fourth point is ensure that post inter-country adoption, financial gains are not there. Now, this is something which is very important because lot many practices were happening, lot many inter-country adoptions were happening where the people were taking advantage of the children and they were exploiting them to earn something, whether through the process of begging, whether by giving them in false kind of adoption, whether giving them to someone who is going to use them for bonded labor or forced labor. So those kind of trafficking kind of things were happening in the names of inter-country adoption. So this has to be like the topmost priority for a state to ensure that post inter-country adoption, the child is not being exploited for any sort of financial gains. Last is bilateral and multilateral arrangements or agreements in cases of inter-country adoption to be promoted. Now this is somewhere a diplomatic kind of arrangement, which is a responsibility of a state that are into this agreement with the state to whom the child will be going after inter-country adoption, that both of the states are on the same page when the concerns are of the welfare of the child. So these are two important articles from the convention which talk about the objective and how the states are going to fulfill those objectives. Now coming to second International Convention, which is the most international convention when we talk about inter-country adoption. It is the Hague Convention on Protection of Children and Cooperation in Respect of Inter-Country Adoption. And the convention is of 1993. And India again has ratified this convention in year 2003. I have highlighted only three objects of the convention because again, the convention is quite a big convention, takes care of almost every aspect of inter-country adoption, but through object, you'll get a bit of the picture of what exactly they wanted to achieve through the convention. So the first objective is A, to establish safeguards to ensure that inter-country adoption takes place in the best interest of the child and with respect of his or her fundamental rights as recognized in international law. So international law through CRC recognizes certain fundamental rights of the children, and those are the basic fundamental rights. Whether you are giving them anything else or not, these are the fundamental rights which must be given to each and every child. Okay, so it is the responsibility of the state to safeguard and ensure that when a child is going for inter-country adoption, his interests are being taken care of and he will get all of these fundamental rights properly with due respect. Okay, second objective is to establish a system for cooperation amongst contracting states to ensure that those safeguards are respected and thereby prevent the abduction, the sale and traffic in children. So definitely when you're talking about inter-country adoption, you cannot go with a state only. There are not many states across these territories you will be sending your child. So there are two states definitely in the picture when you're talking about inter-country adoption. So if one state is ready to grant these fundamental rights and the second state is not in agreement with these objectives, we are ultimately going to fail. So this system that every contracting state is on the same page is also agreeing that this is they are there to safeguard the welfare of the child, to grant them fundamental right, has to be there. And it is through this convention that you can establish a system whereby all the contracting parties, chahe wo bhej rahe ya country ya wo receive kar rahe ya adopting child ko, they have similar objectives, they have similar similar kind of welfare of the child in their mind, and they are preventing any kind of adoption or any kind of exploitation is not going to happen to the child once he would be in that other country. Now coming to the third objective, to secure the recognition in contracting state of adoptions made in accordance with the convention. So as I told you in the beginning that once the adoption is over, whether we are talking about in-country adoption or we are talking about inter-country adoption, once this process is over, the child will have all the rights which are given to a biologically born child of that family. Okay, so if a child is going to some other country after inter-country adoption, definitely it is the responsibility of the state to recognize this adoption. Only if the adoption is recognized, the child can claim all the rights which are supposedly to be granted to him after inter-country adoption. Okay, so all the contracting parties need to recognize the adoption, make it convenient for the child to settle in the family, and then ensure this, that the child will have all the rights which are given to any biological son or daughter in a family. So that's all about the convention. Now let's move to what is the situation of law, what all type of legislations we have in India. So there are three, four legal frameworks specifically talking about inter-country adoption. The first one obviously is the Juvenile Justice Act of 2015. And then there are certain extensions, then there are certain supplementary conditions also, model Juvenile Justice Rule we have of 2016. And then we have adoption regulations in 2017. These regulations were passed and they came into effect in 16th January 2017. To start with, our constitution also lays down the objective through the directive principles. So what exactly are we have in these directive principles? Just a second. Yes, so Article 39, Clause F says that the state shall in particular direct its policies towards securing that child are given opportunities and facilities to develop in a healthy manner and in conditions of freedom and dignity, and the childhood and youth are protected against exploitation and against moral and material abandonments. So this particularly directs the state that this is all you need to ensure that the child is getting this much. And this whole clause basically has financial well-being of the child is being taken care through this one clause. His mental health has been taken care. His freedom has been taken care. His physical health has been taken care. So the state has this directive that you will secure a child in every possible way, whether it's about his physical well-being or mental well-being or financial well-being. Now coming to the Juvenile Justice Act. This again talks about जो हमारे माइनर लेजिस्लेशंस हैं, विच आर नॉट टॉकिंग अबाउट इंटर कंट्री अडॉप्शन, बट आई हैव गिवन अ क्विक रेफरेंस अबाउट देम. सो वी हैव हिंदू अडॉप्शन एंड मेंटेनेंस एक्ट, विच टॉक्स अबाउट अडॉप्शन इन हिंदूज. देन वी हैव गार्डियंस एंड वार्डन्स वार्ड्स एक्ट, अगेन टॉकिंग अबाउट माइनॉरिटी कम्युनिटीज, बट देर इज नो सच कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ अडॉप्शन इन दीज कम्युनिटीज. सो कमिंग टू इंटर कंट्री अडॉप्शन, देर इज नो कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ इंटर कंट्री अडॉप्शन नाइदर इन हामा नॉर इन गार्डियंस और वार्ड्स एक्ट. इन इंटर कंट्री अडॉप्शन इफ यू वॉन्ट टू गो फॉर, you'll have to go with Hague Convention, which was ratified, which was incorporated in Juvenile Justice Act, and that's the only hardcore legislation telling us all about inter-country adoption. So how do Juvenile Justice Act defines adoption? Just a second. The adoption definition which is there in Juvenile Justice Act is basically the definition which has been adopted by CARA as well. So the definition again is same which I explained earlier. One is the negative part and one is the positive part. The negative part is that we are separating the child from his biological parents, definitely properly justified reasons right there, legally the process is done, and then we are taking him, or we are implanting him rather, in a new family, and these adoptive parents are going to grant him all the rights, all the privileges and the responsibilities that are attached to any biological son or daughter, child. Now coming to what are the fundamental principles, what are the fundamental or rather the basic elements which are incorporated in JJ Act in order to regulate all kind of adoptions. So there are basic objectives which are being fulfilled through various provisions of either the adoption regulations or JJ Act. I have enlisted them all here, and I have written the particular provision which deals with this particular element of inter-country adoption. So you can go through the legislation part later on. So the first one is right to family. So yes, the fundamental principle that governs the adoption, inter-country adoption or yeah, in-country adoption, that every child has a right to have a family. And if the child is being deprived of this right by any means, it is the responsibility of the state to give him this family, to grant him this right to have a family. And Juvenile Justice Act tells us how and when and through what mechanism the state is going to grant this right to a family-less child. Okay. The second one is the fundamental principle: child's best interest shall be paramount. So now you can see that every legislation nowadays is focusing more upon filiation, is focusing more upon that this is the affiliation, this is the alliance which has been created for a child. This is a right which has been granted to a child. So parents, definitely we are going to take care of childless parents as well, but our first prerogative, but our first priority would always be the child and his best interest. Then the third one is socio-culture environment. Now this socio-culture environment is something on the basis of which you will go through a lot of Supreme Court or High Court judgments, jahan pe initially there is an inclination towards in-country adoption because we'll have a similar kind of socio-cultural environment. So it would be benefit for the development of a child if he remains in the same socio-cultural environment where he was born. So initially, courts were more towards this kind of reasoning. in-country adoption should prevail over inter-country adoption because adjustment would be easier. Adaptation in the new premises, in the new family would be easier for the child, okay? Then the fourth one is registered on Carings. So what exactly is Carings? It's a database, basically. I'll explain what Carings is. So every inter-country adoption would happen through Carings. And this Carings has been governed and regulated by CARA, which is again a government agency. So no private adoption, no personal understanding through adoption is going to happen if a child is crossing the territory. So whenever an inter-country adoption is happening, it has to be in a very registered manner, and we have an agency which is going to take care of this registration. That agency is Carings, which works under the authority of CARA. Okay, and fifth one is confidentiality. So initially, if you go back to 1960s and 70s, there was this trend. If we have a very poor family, we want to give away our child in adoption, people used to advertise for adoption. And that advertisements basically used to haunt the child throughout his life. The social stigma used to be there. The child would always have this identity crisis. So this confidentiality again is necessary to, mental growth of the child. And that is why confidentiality again is a fundamental principle when we are talking about in-country adoption and inter-country adoption also. So these are the fundamental principles governing adoption. And these principles, every one of it is being incorporated in JJ Act or the regulations which deal with inter-country adoption. So what are the highlights of the legislation? There are few things which you would understand by few of the highlighted parts of the legislation. Number one, it's a secular act, not like Hindu Adoption or Maintenance Act or Guardianship Act, which we're talking about some specific communities or religious communities rather. This is a secular act, okay? And the secular act alone is going to inter-country adoption. Okay, nothing in this act shall apply to adoption under HAMA. So there are certain kinds of adoptions which are happening in Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act. So this act is not going to make those kind of legislations questionable. The act is here to guide inter-country adoptions and certain specific adoptions, but it is not going to invalidate any adoption which is done properly under HAMA. All inter-country adoptions shall be done as per the provisions of this act and adoption regulations framed by the authority. The respective provisions are given in the bracket for your quick reference. Children up to the age of 18 years can be adopted under this act. Orphaned, abandoned and surrendered children. Okay, the term here is OAS. OAS stands for orphan, abandoned or surrendered children. Declared legally free for adoption by CWC, it's a child welfare committee, can be placed in inter-country adoption or for in-country adoption as well. Children of relatives as defined in JJ Act can be adopted by inter-country parents. So initially, what was the position when we started giving away children for inter-country adoption? Children of relatives ka jo adoption hota tha, that was not considered to be inter-country adoption per se. But now, even if it's an adoption which is happening between relatives, that kind of adoption is also if having this inter-country adoption element, the child is going to cross the territory. Okay, although the adoption is happening between the relative, but child is going to cross the territory, there is the person who is adopting is not residing in India, that is an inter-country adoption, then definitely this adoption will also happen through JJ Act only. Okay, now what all kinds of adoptions are there when we are talking about inter-country adoption? There is one adoption, as I just told you, is OAS, which is orphan, abandoned or surrendered children ka adoption. And then we have a second category of adoption, which is relative adoption. And there is a bit of procedural differences amongst these two kinds of adoptions. Now, these are the stakeholders, and for your convenience only, I enlisted these. These are the terms I'll be using throughout when we are talking about the procedure. So you can go through these stakeholders' ke naam and the short forms we are going to use quickly. So we have PAPs. These PAPs are known as prospective adoptive parents. Okay, within the country, if the adoption is happening or it is happening inter-country, both the times the adoptive parents, the prospective adoptive parents rather, are known as PAPs. Then we have specialized adoption agencies. Now, these agencies have quite a big network, and they are going to record, they are going to keep the reports, they are going to go for the investigations also. So these are authorized agency which are in term with CARA or foreign agencies as well. These agencies are known as specialized adoption agency, SAA. Then we have child care institutions. Then we have state governments. Okay, state adoption resource agencies. These are state agencies, again, in term with CARA. CARA is Central Adoption Resource Authority. These SARAs, basically, they work under CARA. Then we have District Child Protection Unit, DCPUs. They are again registered with CARA. We have Authorized Foreign Adoption Agency, AFAAs. We have Central Authorities, CAs, and we have Indian Diplomatic Mission in receiving countries. Now, this Indian Diplomatic Mission is basically in those receiving countries which are not signatories of Hague. When we have Hague signatories, both the parties, where the child is residing and where the PAPs are residing, if both of them have signed Hague Convention, then the agency which will be dealing are AFAAs. And Indian Diplomatic Mission works where the receiving country has not signed Hague Convention yet. Okay, then we have Child Welfare Committee, which is CWC. Now, coming to eligibility of PAP, Section 57 deals with it. A couple or single parent can adopt. Single male is not eligible to adopt a girl child. There's nothing much to explain, not many intricacies involved here. Just 1 minute. Then we have PEP's age eligibility criteria. Again, is been defined. Minimum 2 years of stable marital relationship is mandatory. PAPs with three or more children shall not be eligible to adopt a normal OAS child. And I'll tell you who is a normal OAS child and who is an abnormal OAS child. Eligibility and suitability of PAPs are ascertained through a home study by SAA. And that home study is a conclusive proof when we define whether a PAP is eligible to go for inter-country adoption or not. Now, coming to the procedure of how the child is declared by CWC that this particular child is free for adoption. Now we can give this child away in adoption to a PAP. Okay, so OAS child produced before CWC within 24 hours. So you find a child, or a child is surrendered by the parent, or an abandoned child, or a child who has lost his parent. Orphan, abandoned, and surrendered child. Orphan who lost his parents, abandoned, wherein the parents left his child randomly. Then we have surrendered children. Iske various reasons hote. Maybe the child is not medically fit. The parents are not able to take care of him anymore. So they abandoned the child because they cannot take care of him. So there are various reasons wherein the child is basically abandoned by the parents. And then we have surrendered child wherein parents willingly give away their child in adoption. Okay. So this OAS children, they are produced before Child Welfare Committee within 24 hours of when they are found. And then they are placed in CCI or SAA for immediate care through a written note. These are the institute, child care institute mein, special adoption agencies mein, because right now we don't have a family for them. So immediately through a written order, they are sent to these agencies. Now, procedure of declaring legally free undertaken by DCPU. So we wait for few days. We wait for a certain period of time so that if there is anyone who can come and claim the child, will have a due time limit. If they want to come, if they want to claim a child, we are going to wait for a reasonable period of time, okay, before declaring a child legally free. So once we have completed all these procedural requirements, finally DCW declare a child legally free. Now this child can be given away in adoption. What is the procedure of this OAS children when he is going for inter-country adoption. Okay, so first of all, we are going to prepare a home study report of PEPs. First of all, we'll have to find out whether the person who is asking for a child in adoption, whether this person is eligible, whether this person is qualified as per JJ Act, whether this person is financially, physically, mentally capable enough, and it would be in the welfare of the child if he goes with this particular parent. Okay, all these requirements are basically provided in the convention. So if the country is Hague signatory country, definitely there are foreign agencies which are authorized foreign agencies for adoption who are going to prepare this home study report. If the other country jahan pe PEPs are residing is not a Hague signatory country, then Indian mission is there. That through this mission, there is a whole network. Through this network, we are going to prepare a home study report. Now, what is CARINGS? CARINGS is basically Child Adoption Resource Information and Guidance System. Now, this is a database basically, and if you want to go for inter-country adoption, at every stage, you'll have to include CARINGS in your process, whether it is since the beginning when you are getting registered, whether it is about uploading your document, authenticating your document, getting them notified, getting them registered. At every process, every documentation would be done through CARINS. It is a database which is regulated, which is provided by CARA in India. Okay, so once we have prepared this home study report, these PEPs are being registered in CARINS. And then they upload their documents. And obviously AFA, ya aapka CA or Indian Mission in the cases of non-signatories, they are going to cross-check whether the documents which are being uploaded are the proper documents. They are not being forged, they are not being tampered. Then there is this initial approval by CARA. So once these PEPs are being cross-checked through CARINGS by CARA that they are qualified, it would be a good family for the children, then the child referral part comes. Now there is this child referral and reservation. Again, it is being documented. It is being done through CARINGS. Okay. Then child matching by SA and acceptance by PEPs. Once this acceptance happens, then only a no objection certificate is issued by CARA. Now there is one option. If once this adoption procedure you have attained the status of NOC, you have attained a no objection certificate from CARA, there is one option which you can choose: pre-adoption foster care. This is where you will, through a guided supervision, you would keep the child with you, you would develop a rapport with him, you would develop a good equation with him before going ahead. Only few of the parents, prospective adoptive parents, they choose this option. But yes, the option is very well available. Then finally, there is a court order. Now this court order is basically an approval. This court order is going to be a proof that the court, the law has created this family. This court order is a proof that adoption happens through the due legal process and the child belongs to these parents now. Okay, once then the child, this child arrival, citizenship, post-adoption follow-up till 2 years happens once this inter-country adoption is complete within our country. The last part is happening in the receiving country, which is abroad, the foreign country, not in the territory of India. So this is the whole process of inter-country adoption in the case of orphaned, abandoned and surrendered children. Then the second category is relative adoptions. Yahan pe there is the process, ek do steps hain which we are going to miss. So inter-country adoption in the cases of relatives, when the relatives are adopting. So again, home study report, definitely we are going to make. The whole documentation is going to happen in CARA. The home study report is being prepared by authorized foreign adoption agency, Indian Diplomatic Mission. Then they upload the documents as it was done in the earlier case. Then initial scrutiny is done by CARA. So yahan pe the CARA, the agency, is not giving the referral. Yahan pe agency is scrutinizing, because you are claiming that it is a relative adoption. Definitely we are going to scrutinize, we are going to check your credentials, we are going to check the relationships, we are going to check why this relative adoption is happening, why the parents are giving their child to their relative through the process of adoption. Okay, so here, instead of referral procedure, the scrutinizing, the scrutinization rather, is happening. Then there is verification again and recommendation by state adoption resource agencies. Then pre-approval happens, then filling of the application happens, and herein you will submit your mutual willingness that I am ready to take in adoption, the other family is ready to give away the child in adoption. So we have filed our mutual consent, but definitely, because the child would cross the territory, we need approval of the court. So court is going to again approve the child, that the child is been given, and this certificate, this court order is going to definitely benefit the child when he is going for passport, when he is going for exit visa, and again post adoption follow up still will happen even in these cases also. Now coming to post adoption procedure or follow up. Now this is one important thing, because aap kitna bhi you've taken care when the child is being given away in adoption, once the child crosses the territory, if the state is not behind him, he'll be in a very vulnerable position. He wouldn't know anyone there in the foreign territory. He would not have any sort of family to back him up. He would not have anyone to take care whether he's been granted his fundamental rights, proper status in the family or not. So it is, this part is basically the most important part, because this is when the exploitation happens, if there is anything wrong about to happen to the child. So this is where you need to take extra care, and this is where you need to take care of the child more than any time before this. Okay, so what exactly is going to happen now? We are going to keep a follow-up. We are going to check how the child is being treated. And initially, this is going to happen quarterly. And then first year, quarterly, we are going to follow up. Then we'll start biannually after second year. And every report would be uploaded. Every report would come to Carings. So even now, once the adoption process is complete, Carings is there. Kara is keeping an eye. We are keeping all the records. We are keeping an eye how the child is being treated in the foreign country. Okay, then if there is any adjustment problems coming, if there is any kind of difficulty the child is facing, whether it is his physical well-being or his mental well-being, or whether in the receiving country there are some technical glitches jiski wajah se he is not able to settle down there, this is again going to be the responsibility of Kara here to make sure that the child is settled properly. Then if it is necessary for the well-being of the child, AFA or CA or any government department which is concerned may organize an annual get together to be facilitated by Indian Diplomatic Mission in the cases where the countries are not signatories of Hague. Now this basically happens when we are talking about relative adoptions. Yahan pe, because families are known, so it is very convenient, it is in fact advisable by the court repeatedly that it is good, it is beneficial for the child as well to hold an annual get together, so that the child is also having a good rapport, child is also finding it convenient to settle down quickly in the foreign country and to meet his family which he has left behind. Now this is how you can sum up the whole process of inter-country adoption. So as in the beginning I told that there are two perspectives. By now it must be clear to all of you that the current law, the current legal framework, because we started when we were following our rituals, we were following smritis, we were following dharma shastras, where the only concept of adoption was if a parent is going to die without leaving a son behind, who is going to perform his last rituals, who is going to perform shraddh for the parents, definitely you need a son to do all that. So it was dharma generated concept. The reason behind adoption was we want a son to perform our last rituals, to perform our rituals, to carry forward our lineage. But now it is not the parents' perspective. We are not doing this for a father, for a son, sorry, for a father or a mother. We are doing this particularly for a child. We are giving him an affiliation. We are giving him, we are creating rather an alliance of a child with a family, because we think that this is going to be in the welfare of child. So the whole inter-country adoption is more filiation based rather than a paternity based concept. So yes, it is filiation. This filiation process is on record. The adoptive parents are going to bring the whole adoption procedure on record. We have carings to take care of that. And then the birth certificate is granted, which again is a certificate that proves the alliance, that proves the paternity, that proves that the child belongs to these parents now, the adoptive parents. And then we have a court order again. The court order is an attested photograph is also fixed there. Approved by the court also is there. The proof is there that it has been approved by the court. And this court order has a big sanctity. It is legally document that is going to make the other receiving state responsible, that because the court has authorized this inter-country adoption, now it is your responsibility that you receive the child properly, grant him his due fundamental rights, take care of his welfare while he's staying there in your territory with his new family. And that is how a juridical family is created through inter-country adoption. Now coming to few of the judicial activism cases or judicial pronouncements which are related to inter-country adoption, and few of them are very progressive kind of judicial pronouncements. So first case I would like to refer is Rasika Lal Chagandal Mehta's case. Now this happened where, in this case what happened, there was this inter-country adoption, and this inter-country adoption suddenly was questioned only on one basis, that the inter-country adoption happened through HAMA, through Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act, which is an act which deals with adoption which are happening in country. So because the act is not governing, is not regulating inter-country adoption, they questioned an inter-country adoption. So what was held by the court? That okay, we agree that the adoption happened through a domestic legislation. The legislation deals with in-country adoption, but because the state is not raising any conflict with this law, we are not going to cancel this adoption. Only on this ground, we are not going to say that we are going to cancel the adoption, because it would be very traumatizing for a child now. Okay, so first case wherein the prevalence was given, the preference was given to the right of a child. Now coming to the next case, again, the most important case, as I told you in the beginning, Lakshmikant Pandey versus Union of India, 1984 ka case hai, aur us time ke liye it was a very, very, very progressive judgment given by the Supreme Court. The case started with an application which was given by an advocate who was practicing in Supreme Court, and he specifically mentioned few of the cases, few of the stories wherein the child were given in adoption and that adoption was not documented, was not registered, was not with due legal process. And then they, later on, there were not many children who were given in adoption like that. And these, all the cases were of inter-country adoption. So these adoptions, after these adoptions, these children were not treated well. In fact, they were exploited by various ways. They were forced into prostitution, they were coerced for the bonded labor thing, they were forced into begging. So all these kinds of exploitations happened with them, and they were not treated well because they were in a very vulnerable position. They were not in their country, they were in a foreign territory, they had no one behind them to take care or to ask whether they are good or not. So they were in a vulnerable position, and definitely there were lot many agencies also taking advantage of that vulnerable position of those children. So this lawyer, he approached the Supreme Court and asked for some sort of streamlining. You should streamline the process of inter-country adoption. You should keep an eye on inter-country adoption so that all the children who are crossing the territory in the name of adoption are treated well there in the receiving country. And on relying on this particular letter, the Supreme Court basically discussed the whole process in quite a detailed manner, and they came up with a solution. So they said that let's make an agency, and let's make this agency responsible to take care of all the aspects of inter-country adoption since beginning, from the home studies of a prospective adoptive parents, the moment a parent would think about getting a child from India through adoption, he would come and face CARA first of all. So CARA is going to keep an eye on the process throughout, rather not on the process, but even after the child is being taken through inter-country adoption, CARA is going to keep an eye on this child post-adoption also. CARA was statutory recognition CARA ko grant hua through Government of India ka rule of 33, and it is a very well incorporated in juvenile justice rules of 2007 as well. Now coming to few of the other cases which are talking about different aspects of international inter-country adoption. First of the cases, Society of Sisters of Charity, Saints Garasa Convent. Now this is the case jahan pe specifically we discussed that why are we given preference to in-country adoption rather than going for inter-country adoption. Although I have given you a hint, but still I'll tell you the reason behind it. Why it is see, our first preference is, our whole objective behind inter-country adoption is welfare of child. When we are talking about welfare of child, his mental well-being definitely is going to play a very important role. And as far as the mental well-being of a child is concerned, he will adapt sooner. He will grow mentally in a better way if he is residing, if he is placed in a family who belongs to the same origin, who is having same sort of culture, same sort of ethnicity, the social cultural elements are same as compared to inter-country adoption, wherein he's sent to a foreign territory, altogether different culture, altogether different origin, the different language also. So that's the rationale behind giving preference to Indian parents, Indian origin, in-country adoption. And the second preference initially was given to inter-country adoption. Now coming to the second case, which is Varsha Sanjay Shinde's case. Yahan pe what happened that, okay, we have established the fact that in-country adoptions are more in welfare of children because they help them grow properly mentally. But just because a child is going to have better adaptation in the same premises, in the same origin, you cannot deny him an opportunity. You are keeping a child in hold and no in-country adoption is happening for him, then you should go for the second option, which is inter-country adoption. Just because the child is initially going to find it difficult to adjust there, you cannot deny him the right to get a parent, which is a parent who is residing in a foreign territory. That cannot be the only reason to deny him the right to have a family. Now, two of the cases which are talking about the technical elements, because we have discussed in detail, there are so many intricacies, there are so many procedural requirements, although these procedural requirements are there to keep a vigilance on the procedure so that the child is not being vulnerable. But at the same time, you'll have to keep this in mind that why exactly are we going into so much of the details? Why exactly are we going for those many technicalities when we go for inter-country adoption? Ultimately, the welfare of the child is something that we want to achieve. So if more of your focus is on the technicalities, and these technicalities are making it difficult for a child to get a family, then what is the purpose these technicalities are solving? So that is why the court said that yes, they are a guiding procedure, they are a guiding factors, but again, keep this in mind that ultimate aim is benefit of the child. So for that benefit, if you have to ignore few of the technicalities, that is allowed, that should be allowed. You should not question an inter-country adoption only because one of the technicality was not fulfilled in a proper way. Okay, but having said that, there is another case, Union of India versus Ankur Gupta, and a very recent case. Isme the court said that okay, we allowed that you can blend the rule, but this blending of rule must lie with the courts or legal procedure ke through you can bend it. If again we would leave this in the hands of parents or leave this in the hand of private agencies, again we would go back in time and we leave a gap for the people to take advantage of the children in vulnerable situations. So blending of rule, yes, we allow it, but it should be in the agencies, in the hands of the agencies who are authorized. Now, what is happening because of these procedures, because of these progressive judgments of the courts, and because of the thorough interventions by the court, this is in a way causing hardship for the BAPs. So I'll give you a few of the examples and you can read the details, but there is a case wherein the adoptive parents were made to FD karo ek 5 lakh rupees ki every year in the name of your adopted son. An FD worth rupees 5 lakh every year in name of the adoptive child. Second, again, an FD of rupees 10 lakh in the name of a child. And this was forced. This was basically told to the adoptive parents that this is the prerequisite. Then only we would match a child. Then only we would grant you a child. Then there is that donate rupees 1 lakh rupee to this charity fund and then you'll get a child. So these agencies again are making it quite hard for PAPs. Now, what exactly are the concerns which we should address while talking about inter-country adoption? These technical glitches, these technicalities, most of the times they cause delay. And this delay is basically going to affect the child mentally, and they are taking away, they are delaying a child to have a right to have a family. These adoption cases must be looked by sensitivity and according to due priority. So unnecessary delay we must avoid, whether we are talking about the agencies or we are talking about the courts or we are talking about the foreign authorized agencies who are preparing home study reports. So every agency at every step should be sensitive enough, should be quick enough so that the child is not waiting endlessly. Rules and regulations must be followed in letter and spirit. So yes, you have to follow the rule, but ultimately our objective must be clear in each and everybody who is involved in his mind that we want the child to have a good family. Timelines are stipulated, must be strictly adhered to in the interest of the children who cannot represent for themselves. So that's all about inter-country adoption. If you have any question, I can take those questions.
Thank you, ma'am. It was indeed a very insightful and informative session. Okay, so now the floor is open for questions. Participants, you can post your questions in the chat box and I will be addressing them. Kindly pose them and not unmute yourself. It will just cause confusion. We have a question, ma'am. It says, do you think that the traditional Hindu adoption law should be repealed? Because it seems that adoption provisions related to adoption in the Hindu Act, Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act, are in conflict with the new regulations of the JJ Act.
Yes, definitely, I think it's high time that we should repeal it, because most of the adoptions which are happening through HAMA are the adoptions which are either not documented. Even if they are documented, they are not registered through proper channels. And then later on, when it's about granting the child few of the legal rights, it complicates the whole process. And it is in progress, basically. There are people who have prepared draft, there are bills being prepared, which are saying that we should include all sort of, whether it is about minorities, whether it's about Hindus, whether it's about any sort of religious community, we should streamline all the adoptions, and we should bring them within the ambit of JJ Act so that we have a uniform code, we have a uniform procedure which is guiding all the adoption cases, whether they are in country or they are inter-country. Definitely, the child will have a better say if the whole process is documented, the whole process is legally intervened, and there is someone who is keeping a close eye on the process and vigilation is throughout.
Thank you, ma'am. A follow-up question to that. Let's say if, you know, a uniform code is applied in India in the near future. So how do you think it will affect these inter-country adoptions and specifically these particular acts which govern different religions? What do you think will be the course which can be taken?
Whenever we are talking about any concept, whether it is inter-country adoption or any concept wherein you cross the territory, the only problem that starts that we face is that there is always a conflict of law. It is not necessary that what is our intention in India, what is our objective in India, the same objective is being there in Germany, for example. So this conflict is basically one element which makes inter-country transactions, whether they are private or they are state related, very complicated. This conflict of law is the crux, is the reason that everything, every concept that crosses the territory is complicated. So usme bhi, if we are having various laws which are governing Indian adoptions, an Indian child, if Hindu is being governed by Hama, if he is Muslim is governed by Guardianship Act, if you are going to go for a secular kind of legislation, you have JJ Act. So already in country, we are having so many conflicting legislations. So the moment we are going to cross the territory, the complication would be way more than in the case it would be jab we will having a uniform civil code, will be having a law, a single law which will be generating, which will be governing, rather regulating the adoptions in our country. So it would simplify the procedure. Definitely the conflict would be there. I'm not ruling out that possibility, but that conflict would be less, because then as Indians we'll be having one law to govern us and then another law of the receiving country, not as present where we are having three laws of ourselves conflicting with each other, and then you have a foreign territory and its law also. So that situation is very complicated. At least it would be simplified a bit if we have uniform code.
That's true, ma'am. And another question is that to what extent do you think that India is Indian laws are consistent with the international obligations or the standards which are set forth regarding adoption, especially inter-country adoption? And are there specific areas where India needs to work on to reach that bar of standard?
As far as on record, on people, on paper, when we say there is this law in black and white, so as far as the black and white law is concerned, we are sorted. We have an agency which has guidelines, properly framed guidelines, a recent agency which talks about, which deals with totally contemporary social scenario of India. So on record, on papers, as far as the law or the guidelines or the regulations are concerned, hum bahut time ke saath chal rahe hain. We have contemporary legislations, we have incorporated all possible social changes which were happening in India, but as far as the implementation part is concerned, there are lot many discrepancies which are still there. There are people who are working on the commission basis and giving away children. There are people in the cases of orphaned, abandoned and surrendered children. How many people would take a child to an agency and would not exploit a child at the first hand? How many children who are abandoned, who are surrendered, are taken to CWC? Those children are abducted, those children are taken in the custody by the exploiters, by the traffickers, by the people who are taking, who are you know, craving for those kind of children, that we find this kind of child and we are going to use him for the begging purpose. So this kind of implementation where every child who is deprived of the family is in the safe hand at the first place. Before going to CWC, there is a child of 2 years, there is a child of few months. How are you going to ensure that the child reaches CWC? The child is there on record of carings. There are thousands of the possible moments wherein the traffickers, the bad people would have the first access of this child, and he would be open for all kind of exploitations. So as far as the law is concerned, as far as the written part, as far as the legislation is concerned, we are quite sound. But as far as the practical element, the implementation part is concerned, definitely the networking needs to be strong. The people, the police people, the people who are working on the ground level, whether they are NGOs, whether they are government agencies, whether they are normal citizens, everybody should be vigilant enough. Everybody must know where to take a child, how to treat a child, what is the next step, what am I supposed to do with this child. And this sort of awareness, this sort of quick and proactive approach is lacking in India. So that's the whole problem with the inter-country adoption also, that child is clueless and nobody else is also having a clue where to take him.
That's true. And a follow-up question to that, when it comes to regulating and ensuring that the child is in good hands post-adoption, how do you think the security, social security norms and the follow-ups by social workers, is it up to date? Are they ensuring that the child is in good hands? And what is the routine regarding post-adoption process?
See, the post-adoption process is basically done by foreign agencies who are again authorized agencies. So the way we are having CARA, that's the same sort of agency we are having in the receiving country. We have generally given them a term which is Authorized Foreign Adoption Agency, AFAA. So these agencies are at par with CARA. As we have CARA, they have AFAA of different names. Germany ki koi aur hogi, Spain ki koi aur hogi, England ki koi aur hogi. So yes, these sort of agencies are there in the respective countries. And they have their own networks. So yes, because they are also signatories of Hague. We are talking about the cases where both the parties, the sending party and the receiving party, both of the countries are signatories of Hague. So definitely these countries, they know what is the objective of Hague. While preparing the report, they are going to keep this in their mind that this is the report and this is how this report is going to leave an impact on the future of the child. So they visit the family. They not only interrogate, but yes, they talk to the child, they talk to the parent, they keep an eye on their financial status, they keep an eye on their relationship as well, how the family behaves with each other, not the child only, but also the way husband is treating the wife or the way wife is reciprocating. So all these elements through continuous visits, through vigilance, through by talking to the child, this report is quite a comprehensive report. And this report is basically an authentic report because they are on the same terms. They are on the same page. Their objective is same because they have signed Hague Convention with the same set of mind, same attitude they have. So this report is quite an authentic report. This is quite a periodically prepared report. And then we have a mechanism wherein even CARA can appoint specific NGOs or agencies there to cross-check that report. If I find something fishy as an officer of CARA, if I think there is something fishy, these records, they don't appear to be sound, I can appoint an NGO, I can appoint an agent of mine to keep an eye on the family to cross-check it. So basically, an institute, this is how we explain it. Once child is given an inter-country adoption, he would not stop being in custody with the institute. He is still in the custody of the institute. So institute is still responsible for well-being of that child. He is given to adoption to a parent. He is given in the family, but his custody still remains with the institute. And the concept, the line itself is making it very clear that institute is still keeping the welfare of the child as his prime importance element. Okay, so that's how the institute is going to be very careful while going through the reports, while taking care of the child post-adoption also.
Anything else? Question is that okay, so what happens when these parents if they face a divorce, what happens after that? Are there any implications? Can the adoption be revoked if it's an ugly divorce? If the family dynamics change, do the social security norms provide for revocation, or they just follow simple guardianship and custody legislations?
See, once a child is adopted by a family, once this court order that says that child card adoption is granted, once you approve an adoption order through the court, the child is as equivalent as any biological son normally born, yeah, biologically born to a family. It would face the same consequences as any biological child would face in the cases of divorce. He would face the same custodial matters. Jo court mein jayenge, normal family jis tarah se jaati hai, to definitely this child would bear the same consequences. Financial division hota hai, again the child would face the same consequences. The only situation is, suppose now I don't want to keep the child. My family is getting disturbed. Sorry. And now I don't want to keep the child. although this is going to give me put me in a very difficult situation, but for example, I want to abandon the child. I want to cancel this adoption. Number one, I cannot cancel the adoption. Number two, if I want to abandon the child, again, the same procedure would start. You would go to your AFA, you would file an application, and you would give away the child in adoption in an ordinary way, jaise aap ek normally adopt a biological child ko adoption mein dete ho. If you abandon a child, you're a very bad parent, you abandon him. Again, wahan ka CWC kind of agency would take care that the child is free for legally getting given in adoption, and the adoption procedure would start from the very beginning again. So that's how it happens. So basically everything is going to be same once adoption happened. He is a biological child for the adopted parents now.
Okay. Are there any other questions, participants? This is the last chance. If you have any questions, just post it. Okay. I don't see any further questions. So with this, we're coming towards the end of our webinar. I would like to now request our founder director, Priya Sipaha ma'am, to address the vote of thanks.
Thank you. I think Neeru ma'am raised
her hand. Yes, I did.
Yes, ma'am.
Puchlu ma'am, Priya ma'am, puchlu.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Dr. Shivani.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. But ek hi cheez, I just want to ask. That you said this process will, come back again if adoptive parents want to give their child in adoption, because of the reason that adoptive child would be just like a biological child.
Yes, ma'am.
But what goes about it is that adoption is an irrevocable process. Once adopted, will never be given in adoption again. So how come this thing is going to be addressed?
Ma'am, in inter-country adoption, we specifically talk about a position when the child goes to a foreign country, the child becomes the citizen of that foreign country. And definitely, Juvenile Justice Act would not prevail there. He would be bound by
the laws of that country, yes.
Of that country. So if country is permitting, and Hague Convention definitely tells us that if it is for the benefit of the child, definitely you are going to take him away from that family. I'm not saying that the child will be given in adoption, but yes, the child will be given to their child welfare agencies, and whatever would happen to that child would be as per their law in that country. So
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Yes, ma'am. So I really want to thank you for many things. First of all, thank you for accepting my invitation. And I know that you really spare from your busy schedule because I was requesting you since April to be our guest. So first of all, thank you. And secondly, I really want to thank you for selecting such a wonderful topic, because this topic is really need of our, and people even don't know about actual adoption. So inter-country adoption is something really very interesting also and very important also. And thirdly, I want to thank you for the wonderful presentation, because mostly I have seen that even if the speaker is very good, our presentation, the PPT is not very so well defined. So your PPT was also well-defined, and you're a wonderful speaker. So thirdly, I want to thank you for that. And fourthly, I want to thank you because of the wonderful elaborative session and very informative. You have covered each and every aspect in a wonderful manner. So I don't think that there are many more questions, because you have answered all the thing in a very elaborative, yet in a very concise manner. So it is really very useful, informative, and enlightening.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
So thank you so much, and thank you all the audience for listening patiently. And one more thing I want to tell you, because we are having audience from Bangladesh also, and from Australia also, other than India. So I think that is also beneficial for everyone. So thank you again.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And thank you, Neuro ma'am, for joining the session.
And it was my pleasure, Priya ma'am. Really great.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much for your attention and time.